Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, I want to hear about it. And so does everyone else. You know the drill. Go on. Put all the details in an email and send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hey there, everyone. Thanks for stopping in this evening. Now, go on and make yourself comfortable. Don't forget your snackage and drinks, because we're going to get started right away out on the trail tonight. Our first two stops are right here in the Buckeye State of Ohio. But the third and final stop will take us all the way to Washington State. Now, yes, that's quite a leap in distance that we have to cover, so you know, I think we should probably get on up in the saddle and hit the trail. I mean, our journey to Sasquatch Valley is a long one tonight, but it's well worth the travel, I think. Are you ready? Let's go. Hi, I'm Jerry from Ohio. I found your program this morning. Lockington Dam, Ohio, is about 45 minutes from my house. We had a picnic with some friends up there. We didn't see a Bigfoot, but we did see a sign that Bigfoot had been there. My 11-year-old son and I went down behind the dam to look around. In the hot, dry summer, with no rain, the river looks like a creek. As we were looking around, we came across roughly 25 to 30 saplings, 1 inch to 2 inches in diameter, 20 feet tall. These saplings were all twisted and broke off, 8 feet to 10 feet up from the ground. I am 72 now, and glad that I know now what did those saplings in. My second story. I was deer hunting down in Athens County in 2000. It was a 5-hour drive from my house. I got down there about midnight so that I could get to my hunting site and get a couple hours of sleep. But on this night, I was too tired to do much climbing. I was getting out of breath. The side of the hill was cut like stair steps. I was on the fourth step, and I couldn't go any further. I found a big tree to use, so I used my sleeping bag on the ground so I could move on top of the leaves without making any noise. I had my camo suit still on, and I was getting ready to get some sleep. But then all heck breaks out. To my right, up at the top of the ridge, something was coming at me, and it sounded pissed off. It was a terrible growl. I grabbed for my gun and realized I had left it in the truck. So I loaded my crossbow. Wow, one shot. But I did have my hunting knife. I grabbed my flashlight. I go to turn it on, and the bulb blows out. Now this is the kind of stuff that only happens in cartoons, but it's still coming at me, and it's still growling. I'm frozen up against this tree. This thing must have a silence mode for walking, because all I hear is that growl. Then I hear it going farther away. Then nothing. It's dead quiet. I never went to sleep that night. Daybreak came, and I got my stuff ready and went home. I've never been in any woods again. No more deer hunting for me. Signed, Jerry. Hi, Nance. I'd prefer that you not use my name. Just call me Brush Creek, simply because I'm well known in my community, and I don't want the location of our not-so-friendly friend to get out, because it should be left to live its life in peace for the few months each year that we have to deal with it. I'm from a very rural area called Blue Creek, Ohio. I have had many, many encounters over the years with the Man of the Woods, but I'll save most of those for another time and share those with you all if you want to hear them. I'll tell you my first memory of the bear and of our last encounter, which occurred 2 nights ago. So, as I mentioned, I grew up in a very rural area at the back of Moon Hollow Road. And, like many families in that time period, kids were often left alone while the parents worked the fields. Tobacco was money, and money meant food, and hopefully Christmas. One evening, my parents were several miles away from home working a crop that they shared, as many others did back then. I was home alone with my brother. I was 7-ish, and he would have been about 4. I was getting him out of the tub and wrapping a towel around him when I turned around to see a bear looking in the back door window, right in at us in the bathroom. Of course, it scared the crap out of me, so I rushed my brother up the hallway to the living room to call my mamma that lived just up the road. We had a party line back then, so you just pushed a number, and it rang the next person on the line. Just as the phone rang and she answered, that darn bear was looking in at us again, only now from the back kitchen window. So I said, "Mamma, there's a big bear looking through our windows, watching us." I heard her gasp and the drop of the phone, and then what seemed like just seconds later, a car was rolling into our backyard. The bear was gone, and she gathered us up and took us up the road with her. It was years later, after an encounter that I had as a teen, that I realized it was most definitely not a bear watching us that night. When I asked Mamma if she believed in what I had seen, she simply said, "We are Appalachian, child. You don't see it, you don't hear it, and you don't acknowledge it. You simply drop your eyes and walk away." That is something I live by to this day. Now, on to the latest encounter. But first, a touch of backstory. 4 years ago, my now husband and I moved to his family farm. No one had resided in that old farmhouse or used that part of the farm for about 15 years. Not long after, and we moved in around November 2018, but not long after, we realized we were not the only ones that lived on that piece of property. But that's a story for another time. So, anyhow, 2 nights ago, my now mother-in-law and I are sitting on her front porch chatting while my husband and my brother-in-law finished up some chores. That's when we hear something in the woods, growling with every breath it took. The dogs all started going nuts. We instantly looked at each other and said simultaneously, "That thing is back, and he's early." We deal with our friend from around mid-October till mid-March each year, and then it's silence the other months of the year. I got up, went and told the guys to finish up and come on, because our friend had returned early this season. So, it's back to chores have to be done before dusk, and everyone safely inside before dark. No more peaceful summer nights outside. My husband and I only had our cell phone lights, so we turned them on to walk to the barn and to pull the truck down to the house, shut things up for the night, since our friend was back. As we were walking over, I heard my mother-in-law say to my brother-in-law, "Shine the spotlight so we can see better." As soon as he turned on that light, he said, "There he is." Our friend was standing on the other side of the old semi-truck, just feet away from my husband and I. We didn't see it, however, and as quickly as my brother-in-law did, it was gone. And sorry, everyone, that background noise. That's one of the kittens on his little scratchy cardboard thing. Sorry, I can't keep them out of here. They just scream if I shut the door. Okay, so let me get back to it. We didn't see it, however, and as quickly as my brother-in-law did, it was gone. So we hurried up our pace a little. But I remember, you don't run. And in my mind, I'm thinking the growling was coming from over the hill in front of the house and not behind where the old semi sits. So how did it get there so quickly? We shut up the barn, got in the truck, turned it around, and immediately my headlights hit on a tall figure on the bank in front of our house. And boom, it was gone. Then I realized our friend has a friend now. He isn't alone. They have already made use of most of the garden that was still needing to be picked, and they've taken a couple of rabbits. I'm sure it won't be long till I'm back to cooking with quail eggs from the indoor birds, as it isn't too fond on sharing our chickens' eggs with us. It's a bit greedy. I'm not sure how I feel about there being more than one of them now. What I do know is that there is something sinister about the one that we have always dealt with, and I feel it with this new one also. I think because we allow them to own the farm in the dark, they leave us alone. I have never gotten a good look at it, but there is something in its face that looks more than ape-like, almost baboon-like, and it's as black as a raven. Nothing like what I saw as a child or have seen in other places. Now we live, as the crow flies, about 10 miles from where the Terror in the Woods story of the Ohio Devil Monkey was filmed. Maybe that's what these things are. I don't know. I only know we do as we were all raised to do. You drop your head and you walk away. You never run. You don't see it. You don't acknowledge it. I hope that you can use my story and that it isn't too long to read. Signed, Brush Creek. Then Brush Creek sent in a follow-up email, and here is what they wrote. So, I thought I would let you know the latest events. As I said, they've already taken a few rabbits. Well, last night, they took 5 more, plus a young doling goat. They also took 2 full bags of goat feed that we have mixed at a local mill that has roasted soybeans, roasted sunflower seeds, oats, barley, ground kelp, dry molasses, and other minerals in it. So I guess it smelled good enough for our friend and his new friend to take with them. Now I know all of this sounds completely and absolutely absurd, and that some might think I'm insane. It is what it is. As I said before, it's normally mid-October before we ever see signs that our friend has come home for the winter. So the whole showing up a full 6-ish weeks before we expected, that has sent us into a cram mode. And me, running to the almanac to see what type of winter Southern Ohio is facing. I figure, if he's early, there's a reason. And of course, the almanac is calling for a colder than normal winter, with more snowy precipitation than normal. And as I believe they are in some ways humanoid, I'm certain that like a horse or a cow, getting a heavy winter coat in September shows us that we are in for a rough winter. They know things and understand things that we simply don't have the ability to know and understand. So, this time each year, Labor Day weekend, we have an annual campout with friends and family here on the farm. We cook out, and we break out the projector, the popcorn machine, and cotton candy machine for movie night, and for treats for all the kids. But with our friends arriving early, we have canceled our camping plans under the guise of COVID, simply because I do not trust our friend, nor his new friend. So this weekend is going to be filled with extra work to try and lock things down enough to stop losing livestock. I don't mind a share. I mean, we raise all the extra we can, and we take them to the offering rock throughout the fall and winter months. Yesterday, we moved all of the larger livestock out of the summer pastures in the hills, the goats, the cattle, and the sheep. We moved them down to the winter pastures. We will soon have to feed them hay. Good thing we have had a successful hay season, as it seems we are going to feed a whole extra month. We normally don't have to do that. And we added hot wires around the tops of all the hog pastures to hopefully protect the 3 litters of piglets that we had born, who would have normally been sold off before our friend's normal arrival time. Our livestock guard dogs have been spread out in pairs amongst the stock in the hopes that they can keep our losses at a minimum. We have 14 dogs. Something else people look at me strangely over, but they don't know what we deal with each fall and winter. Nothing is left of the garden, except some late corn that should be ready in September. Electric is going around it today. There again, I'll share, but they are greedy, almost ravenous like this time, because it's been an every night thing once our friend arrives. I reckon the extra mouth to feed, or who knows, maybe there are two extra mouths he's trying to feed. We all know pregnant things crave food. Well, I have rambled on enough. It's daylight now, so I'm going to assess what all took place last night and then get a start on moving the stock and the fencing. Looks as if it's going to be a very busy weekend. Please keep telling your stories. It's a not-so-wonderful thing, and a wonderful thing to hear what others deal with. Makes me feel less crazy in the actions I take here. We simply want to exist in our world, and they in theirs, sharing what we can spare. Stay blessed, and thank you, Brush Creek. Hello, Nance, and hello, Sasquatch. This is my experience with what must have been a Sasquatch or a Bigfoot. This was back in the late 60s, and it was the summer between third and fourth grade. I must have been about 9 years old, as far as I can remember. I was an Army brat, and my mom and sisters and I usually traveled with Dad when the Army would move him. This particular year, he was stationed at Fort Lewis in Washington State, and we lived on base in military housing. Fort Lewis, now known as Joint Base Lewis-McChord, is located roughly an hour south of Seattle. It's surrounded by woods, or at least it was back then. I wasn't allowed to play in the woods because Dad said it wasn't safe, so I wasn't normally out there. But this particular day, a friend of mine wanted to show me something. I refused at first, but she dared me, and she called me chicken. Well, you all know what happens when someone calls you chicken. That's right. I had to prove that I wasn't. So off to the woods we went. As we were walking, I felt a presence. It was that feeling you get when you know something isn't right. I looked to the left, and there was a bear standing there on its back legs. I froze, and I grabbed my friend's hand. When I did, I saw the other animal. She was twice the size of the bear, and the bear was not a baby. I had seen bears before, at the zoo and at Yellowstone, so I knew bears. And I'd seen gorillas at the zoo as well. This was no gorilla. She was more like a cross between a human and a gorilla, but more human. I could tell she was female because she had breasts and she had a baby clinging to her. She had no hair on her face, but the rest of her body was covered in brown, shaggy hair with copper highlights. Her skin was also kind of light brown. The bear started to growl, and the mama Sasquatch, though I didn't know that that's what she was yet, well, she got between us and the bear. She let out a scream that went through my whole body, like a vibration. I nearly fainted right there. Then the bear ran off. When the mama looked back at us, her face was kind instead of fierce. She pointed back in the direction that we'd come from, as if telling us to go home. I wanted to go and hug her as a thank you for saving us from the bear. But she looked at me as if to say, "It's okay, you're safe now. Go home." I felt as if I'd heard her voice in my head, so my friend and I headed back. I felt the Sasquatch's presence with us until base housing came back in sight. As we got to it, we finally found our voices and swore never to tell or to talk about what's happened. I mean, who would have believed a couple of 9-year-old girls anyway? Nance, I know there must be different kinds of Bigfoot or Sasquatch, as they are commonly called in the Pacific Northwest. There are tales from around the country where some are mean and vicious, but the one I met was nice. I never felt scared of her. I haven't seen another Sasquatch since. My friend has since passed away, so I now feel I can share this experience. By the way, my dad was a Buckeye. He lived there for the first 19 years of his life. A few years before he passed away, I asked him if he'd ever heard of the Ohio Grassman, as I had been watching many Bigfoot documentaries on television. Well, maybe they don't have any in Wyandotte County, which is where he grew up. While I know my story isn't very scary, I hope it's worth a read anyway. Thank you in advance if you do. All the best. Signed, Lori. Well, Lori, I appreciate that you took the time to send that story in. It doesn't have to be terrifying, but we as adults hearing that would be absolutely terrified to hear any child we know describe that kind of an event. And I mean, we've all seen and heard the reports in the last few years of a missing child who is found and insists that a bear kept them safe. And most of us have to wonder, and some of us firmly believe, that that child was saved and cared for by a Sasquatch. It makes you wonder, doesn't it? And as for you, Brush Creek, please do send in the other stories for another time that you mentioned. Of course we want to hear them. I feel like I have to say that a lot. And please, if you're listening, never question if we want to hear an encounter story, because I'm pretty sure we do, especially about how you figured out you were not the only people inhabiting that part of the farm, or the farm in general. And Jerry, I also appreciate that you sent in your experiences and observances. If you have any more, by all means, please send those in as well. All right, everyone. Well, I'm going to call it quits for tonight. Don't have much else to say. If you heard all kinds of squeals or scratchings and things in the background, again, the kittens are running wild. I mean, they are 2 months old now. They are 8 weeks. Is that right? 8 or 9 weeks? And they are just off the hook. So I think at least two of them will be going home with one of our own Sasquad, hopefully this next weekend. I'm getting them vaccinated, and then they're going to their new homes. I've got two more going to another person I know. And as for the fifth one, her name is Sage, and she will be staying with us. All right, everyone. Well, thanks for putting up with me and all the kittens. Until we meet up again, as always, please remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.